Good morning. Yeah, so it's a beautiful day outside. I'm excited that the weather's warming up. So I got my house ripped all apart, and I disconnected our air conditioning last in the winter time, thinking I would have more done than I do. And so now my wife is getting hot. So yeah, open the windows. I tried to tell her that, and it did not work. So apparently women they get hotter than guys do, which is rightly so because she's beautiful, and so that makes sense. today is going to be, I just want to kind of just talk to you guys about where I feel like that we are in a church is across the world, what the church is looking like. So last week we talked about Jesus hanging on the cross. Last week we talked about him raising from the grave and conquering death, dying on the cross to secure our life from sin so we don't have to live in sin anymore. And then 3 days later, raising from the dead to conquer death so we could have full access to heaven. And I don't think you really know what that means, to have full access to heaven. See, God uses everything in life to, we can look at and see things that he does, you know, with relationships, all these things, how to have relationships. He showed how to have good relationships with the disciples. He showed how to talk to people. He showed when there's people bucked up against him, how you could approach them in a way that's still in love. His whole focus was loving people and loving people well. And so we have a complete full access to heaven. It's no different than when you was a kid and you come home as a kid and walked into your house and you had full access to the refrigerator, whatever, in the house. Maybe your parents' rooms were off limits. Maybe some of this stuff was off limits. But you had full access to be able to enter in to your own home and enjoy the pleasures of the home. Now, me growing up, my parents eventually, when we got older, put locks on the refrigerator, and I'll tell you why. It's because, and I'm not even exaggerating about that, they put locks on the refrigerator because we would go and just grab all the stuff that didn't need to be cooked. And so if we had to cook it, we didn't eat. So they locked it. They had this strategy, and I don't know. But when I was 16, I remember the refrigerator being locked. And it might have been because of my brother and sisters, maybe not because of me. But I believe that God has given us full access to the heavenly realms. We have the fullness, and I believe everything is unlocked for us. As we dig in deeper, as we walk closer, he reveals more and more and more things to us. When we dig into the Word of God, he unlocks the Word even more and more and more so we can understand even more. And I believe today that God is bringing it back around to where he is center of everything. If we can start focusing on putting him center of every part of our life, not just some of our life, but every single part of our life, putting God center. That means when you plan on a trip to have fun, make sure you center up with Jesus first. When you go to spend money, make sure you center up with Jesus first. Let him be center of every decision that you make, every decision in your life, that you know that you're on the right path because you are asking your dad how to handle your life, what you need to do. Go into the Word. He gives you instruction on what you need to do. And I believe this. I was driving down the road the other day, and actually from meeting Ted, and there was a bridge that was out, but they made this bypass bridge. And I believe that's where the church is. We're passing on the bypass bridge and bypassing the bridge that God created to begin with. Because there was a bridge that was created in the beginning that was love. The bridge was love. And God spoke through love, pure love, untainted love. And when Adam and Eve sinned in the beginning, that broke that bridge, that broke that connection that we have. And so that's why Jesus came back to die on the cross for you and I to have that fellowship and that relationship that you and I could walk in the fullness of life, in the fullness of love, giving us the key back to the kingdom so we could enter and come and go anytime we choose. And when he talks about bringing heaven down to earth, that's what he wants. He says, bringing heaven to earth. We should be able to bring heaven down to earth in our daily walk, in our daily life, in our daily living. Bring heaven down to this place that we're at. And I believe God is rebuilding the church body. As I said, with him being the center, not the leader of the church being the center, not the ones with mighty names who are puffed up by men and men have made them mighty, not them, but Jesus. Jesus getting the full force of everything that we have, getting the fullness of everything that we have for him. I believe he wants to eliminate these go-around bridges because there's a lot of going around. People are comfortable with that because of giftings. People walk out of gifting sometimes and not out of love because the gifts are irrefutable. You're going to have gifts of God. They're going to continue to flow out of your life no matter how you're living. You know, someone who's a fortune teller has gifts from God. They're just using them differently than God would have them use them. They're still gifts from God. And so we've been on that bypass road instead of getting on the, or that bypass bridge instead of getting on the bridge that is formed in love and finishing that so we can actually walk in the fullness that God has for us, the complete fullness, walking across the bridge made of love. If you have your Bibles, turn to 1 Corinthians. We're going to talk about love because love is the most important thing of all things. Love is the most important of all. It says, though I speak with tongues, now listen to this, all this carefully. Though I speak with tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clinging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could move mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods and feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, but have not love, it profits me nothing. Love suffers long. Love is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Love is not puffed up. Love does not behave rudely. Love does not seek its own. Love is not provoked. Love thinks no evil. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes for all things, and endures all things. Jesus clearly showed that to us by his love, bearing all, believing all, hoping all, and enduring all. Love never fails. Jesus never once failed any of us, nor will he ever. But where there are prophecies, they will fail. Where there are tongues, they will cease. Where there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. Listen to that. We only know in part because we have not got the fullness that God has for us. That's why it's in part. It will fade away in part. But once we have the fullness of all these things, we will operate in the fullness of them. But when that which is the perfect will comes, then that which is in part will be done away with. It'll be made whole. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child. I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away the childish things. Listen, sometimes I feel like it's good to go back to that and become a child again, knowing that when you flip the switch on, the light's going to turn on. Knowing, having that kind of faith and know as a child, they don't look in the refrigerator and wonder. I mean, some do, but as a whole, they don't think when they open the refrigerator, it's going to be empty. We have some scenarios like that. We have places like that. But us as American people, we don't hardly have that kind of a scenario where we open the refrigerator and it's empty. We just have faith. We trust that there's going to be food there. We trust, we flip the light on, it's going to happen. We trust that mom and dad's going to take care of us. Sometimes we need to go back to walking like a child, thinking like a child, having faith like a child. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know, just as I also am known. And now abides faith, hope, love, and these three, but the greatest of these is love. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you right now for that love that you came to this earth with. And we failed you. We let you down. But God, you came again. You died on Calvary for each one of us to be able to experience the fullness of that love. That you rose again and conquered death, that we could have full access to the kingdom of heaven. Full access to your kingdom. Father, we thank you for loving us, for teaching us how to love well and to become love. In Jesus' name, amen. So if you speak in tongues, I mean, a lot of us do speak in tongues, but some people have different language. I had suffered with someone this week who's spoken a different language. There's all different kinds of languages, and then there's spiritual tongues. It talks about the tongues of men, which would be our languages that we understand. We go to different countries and different language, different tongues that we encounter that are intriguing to us. You know, when I went to Haiti and when I went to Honduras, they spoke in different languages, you know, French and Spanish. And so I understood just a little bit just by how they portrayed themselves, how they acted. Just by their actions, I could understand a little bit of what they were saying. My first experience with this was a young girl named Mary over in Honduras. And she was out there. We were building these roof systems in Honduras and after the flood, and she was drawn to me. She wrote me a letter and I had to have it read in from the translator, and it was so beautiful, the letter that she wrote to me, that she'd send it to me later on. But there were so many people there that were building these roofs. They did not need my help. I did not think they needed my help. They all were supposed to know what they were doing. Later on, I had to help them because I think they did not know what they were doing. But I said, can I go? I told the leader, I said, can I go out and just like gather up the kids and do something with them? I said, I'm not really wanting to build these roofs right now because you got so many people. And they said, yeah. So I gathered almost 100 kids, like really, really quick. And I taught them how to play duck, duck, goose. But it was kind of hard because they didn't speak none of my language and I didn't speak none of their language. But this little girl, Maria, for some reason, she understood me. She didn't speak English, but she understood me and I understood her. Because it was done in love. When we do things out of love, it's not just a noise. It's heard and it's understood. When you speak because of your knowledge or all the stuff that you might know and it's not done in love, it's going to go to a deaf ear and it's not going to be heard like that, because if it's done out of a falseness or out of a false pretense of not love, then people are just going to plug their ears. They're not going to want to hear what you have to say because it's not done in love. When you speak in a heavenly language to the Father, He wants you to speak in love, in that heavenly language. So if you don't understand tongues or you don't understand praying in tongues or praying in the Spirit, this scripture right here says, Paul is saying that we will speak in a language of man, but also a heavenly language. So I'm grateful that I get to speak to my Father in a different language. And I'm grateful that I can speak a little bit of another language. But if I don't speak out of love, I might as well not even be speaking at all. At all. In Matthew 6:7, it says, and when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetitions as the Gentiles do, for they suppose that they will be heard for their many words. They're thinking because they're speaking a lot and they're speaking to the Father and they're praying to the Father, that just because they're saying a lot of words, that means they're going to be heard. That's not true. That's what it's saying. That is not true. It's not by the amount of words they say, it's the heart behind of what we're saying to anyone, especially to the Father. It's the heart position, a heart posturing behind that. Otherwise, it's just a noise. In prophecy, if you prophesy without love, the definition of prophecy is this: an actor interpreting the divine will or purpose. So if you prophesy to someone, you're interpreting the divine will or purpose of God. It says that there will be mysteries in knowledge and faith. Mysteries, the secret plans that God has. You ever go out in the woods and you just see all the different things? You know, Shelly and I went out and we found three mushrooms. Just count it as the Trinity. Father, Son, Holy Ghost, three mushrooms, all we found. But you see it in nature. You see everything. God shows you the mysteries, and He reveals the mysteries of heaven in the nature of this earth, in the nature of people, in the nature of what we see. Knowledge, having a comprehension or intellectual grasp of something as possessed by God. And then having faith. Faith is the utmost trust in God. How big is your faith this morning? Do you have faith to continue to build the bridge and walk across the bridge that has been broken? Or are you going to go in the bypass part of it and just walk and be comfortable with that? It's important that we have faith. But if we have faith, knowledge, and prophecy and mysteries without love, it's going to profit us nothing. It's going to be worth nothing. Matthew 7:22. If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew 7:22. It says, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name cast out demons, and in your name perform many miracles. And he says this to him in verse 23. I never knew you. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. God is saying this to people who have taken the low road around that bridge that is created, the bridge that was made to prepare the bridge. They're staying on that route, on that road, which is the gifting route, the gifting road, and they're not walking in the fullness of love. They will say, haven't we prophesied? He said, I don't know you. Haven't we cast out demons? He'll say, I don't know you. Haven't we performed many miracles? He'll say, I don't know you. Why? Because we have not walked in love. Love is the most important part of it. Love must be the part of the equation that God has for you. And without love, He says we're nothing. We're nothing. So our words are nothing. Our prophecies are nothing. All of our giftings are nothing if we don't operate in them without love. And I know down through the years, we've walked in a tainted version of what love really is. I know that I have. I know when my mom and my dad was whipping me, when I was beaten at different times, I know, like black and blue beaten at different times, I know that wasn't out. Now I know that wasn't out of a true love from God. They thought they were loving me then when they told me to go out and pick a switch off the tree. I know some of you have probably been whipped by a switch before. Maybe some of you haven't. Maybe some of you need to be. But I would go out and I'd break off a switch. And it was almost like every word my mom said was a whack. Like, I told you. Any of you women ever did that to your kids? Every word was a whipping. I'm like, Mom, don't talk when you're whipping me. Just don't talk. Every word. And I would go in circles. I told you not to do that. She thought she was whipping me out of love because it didn't draw me to her. It made me want to run from her. But Jesus, when he disciplines you, it makes you want to draw to him. When Jesus says pick a switch and you pick a switch, don't be sarcastic and grab a log, because I did that before too, a bigger stick, and I got whipped with that too. When Jesus says pick a switch, I'm going to give you something to whine about, something to cry about. He's doing it in love, and when he does it, this is what's going to happen. You're going to walk toward him. Every time the Father disciplines you, you're going to walk towards him. That's disciplining in love. That's what love looks like. First John says, we have come to know and have believed the love of which God has for us, because God is love, and the one who abides in love abides in God, and God abides in him. That's why love is so valuable. It's so important. We can do all kind of things because we're smart people. We can do all kind of things. We can learn all these languages. We can talk the talk and not walk the walk. If we do not have love, it's all void and worthless if we don't operate out of love. Guys, you and I were created in the image of love. Genesis 1:27, at the very beginning, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. And listen to this. This might mess you up. Created him male and female. He created them. I mean, that might mess your mind up. Male and female, he created them. Created in the image of love. If you are of God, then you will work out of love. You will operate out of love because you come from God. Therefore, you are love. It's in you. You're made of love. You're created of love because God is love, and he created you in his image. And if God is love and you're created from God, you are love. It's in you. It's part of you. We just have to tap into that. Quit going to the bypass bridge and get on the bridge and repair. That's God's repair. That Jesus came, died on Calvary, rose from the grave, and repaired the bridge so we could walk across and have heaven and make heaven our home. It says, if you give to the poor, then give your body to be burned. So this is saying, if you take everything you have today and you give to the poor, but don't do it in love, it don't profit you one iota, nothing. Some people give for a tax write-off, and I'm grateful for that. Some people give just to give, and some people give because they love to give, because God has put in them the heart to love to give. In Matthew 6:2, it says, So when you give to the poor, do not sound the trumpet before you. Anybody know somebody like that? And they give something, and like everybody else in the world knows that they gave something to somebody. And when you give to the poor, don't sound the trumpet and I gave somebody something. No, because the hypocrites do that. And he says here, they have the reward. If you give out of that kind of a mindset, if you give to the poor out of a mindset of give to get, you have your reward. You have your reward. Enjoy it. But as far as the heavenly realm, it's good for nothing. It's not going to matter to heaven if you give outside of love. And it says, even give your body to be burned. An example of love that I've seen this week, there was a soldier over in, I'm so grateful for them and thank them for their service at the border. Guys, we have a crisis at the border if you haven't known. There's a crisis at the border. And there was a man that took all of his armor off, all of his gear off. Military, young, I think 30-year-old man, dove into the water to save two people crossing illegally into America. He lost his life. And they were drug smugglers. But I believe that's what love looks like. Love don't look at what the people are doing. Jesus said on the cross, he could have said, I ain't doing this for them at all. I'm backing out. I'm not going to die on the cross. I'm not going to go through that. These people that want me, I mean, it's like, you know, one minute you like love him, next minute you crucify him. And I believe that was a whole different crowd. I believe that they snuck in the night and did some stuff in the dark. And Jesus brought light to the whole situation. But can you imagine Jesus not wanting to hang on a cross for us? But he said, on the cross, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. And I'm saying right now, forgive us, Father, because we don't know what we're doing. We don't know what we're doing by taking the bypass road and being glorified because we have giftings, because we can prophesy, because we can speak cool words, or we can do all these things, that it's not going to matter if we do it out of love. So I'm thankful that Jesus rebuilt the bridge for you and I to get on and cross that bridge. And that way we can love and prophesy. We can love and give to the poor. That we can love and speak in tongues of man and of heavenly hosts. I believe that that's where God is taking us. I believe that's what he wants to do with every one of us, that we can walk in the fullness of love. I want my reward to be ministering to people, the giving of myself to people out of love. I believe that I've learned how to love well. I'm still working on it. I'm still working on it. I will forever be working on how to love people. Sometimes people are hard to love on. For me, I don't know about you guys, but for me, sometimes it's hard to love on people. And so, but God has just did something to me. He's put something in me. He's changed me. He's changed my heart. So this is what love is. Love is patient. How many of you are patient? Husbands and wives, how many of you are patient? Some people do things at a different speed. Learn to be patient. Love is kind. Not just when you're at church, but when you're at home. When you're out in the public, love is kind. Love is not jealous, desiring things that other people have. Because you don't have. Matter of fact, a good rule of thumb with that, if you see something that someone else has that you want, rejoice that they have it. If you see someone getting a check for $5,000, don't go, well, where's my check? Thank God that they got a check for $5,000, because I believe in the rejoicing in other people's blessings, you're going to be blessed. I wholeheartedly believe that. Love does not brag. This was kind of hard for me because I'm trying to understand it a little bit more, because I brag on Jesus. Like, it's hard, like, this, because my name is tagged to Life of Love and what's going on here, it's hard for me not to just talk about what God is doing and not come across that, you know, that it's at Life of Love. He's doing it in the region. He's doing it everywhere. But when I'm telling people, I want to tell them, because they're from here, man, this is what God's doing. This is what's going on. This is crazy, you know, and I vomit all over them, just like everything, you know, so they can get it in case I never see them again. But I definitely never want to brag about what God's doing here, but I know He is doing something special, and we get to be some forerunners for that in this region. Love is not arrogance. Anybody know anybody that's arrogant? Nobody? You guys are good. Man, you got great friends. Great people hanging around you. Good, powerful people. Love does not act unbecomingly. Anybody know anybody like that? It's unpleasant to be around. It's unbecoming. Flattering, not flattering. Not, man, I am around people. I try to set powerful people around my life, but there are people around me that are not very flattering, and it's really unbecoming for me to be around them. But I need to, because I want to minister to them and love on them. But love does not act that way. Love does not seek its own. This is a good one. Love is not provoked. Love is not provoked. So husbands and wives, when your wife or husband comes up to you and says, you remember when you did this? And then you are moved by that, and you're like, well, remember when you did this? And then you have the back and forth. Well, when you did this over here, well, remember what you did here? Well, what about over here? And the next thing you know, it's a big heated blow out, knock down, drag out fight, and then you have to look at it in love and just laugh at it and go, what in the world did I just do? What just happened? Love is not provoked like that. Jesus never got provoked. Anything that anyone said, show me in the scripture, anything that anyone said to him, it didn't move him in a way to make him mad, make him frustrated, make him... It didn't do nothing to him. He's like, he would just speak the truth behind what they would say. Sometimes he would ask a question with a question. Maybe that's a good thing. Ask a question with a question. You know, when your wife or husband says, hey, remember when you do this? And you say, remember how much I love you? Remember how much Jesus loves you? Remember the last time we did this and we ended up in a knockdown drag out and then we laughed? Let's just laugh. Let's do that. Learn how to operate out of love and not be provoked by your husband or wife. Because, I mean, you're around each other so much. My wife's like, we're around each other all the time. Yeah, we get quantity time, but not a lot of quality time. My love language is quality time. I want to have that time with you and I and no phone. You and I and no phone is my, how I like that. And so... love does not take into account a wrong suffered against it. Jesus could have taken all that in account with being beaten and you know, the clothes ripped off of him and crown put on his head. He could have like, because he was fully man, guys, listen, Jesus was fully man and fully God at the same time. If you can comprehend that, the comprehension of that is he had all access of heaven, which we have all access to heaven, and he could have chose to not do these things. So, love does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but it rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things. believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. So let's stand. If you have been walking on the bypass bridge or living your life on the bypass bridge, not letting love be the center of your life, not letting love be the focus of your life, then you need to pray today. Because Jesus paid that price and reconnected the structure on the bridge so we could have access to heaven. And if you have walked out of anything other than love, you're not in right alignment with Jesus. You're not in right alignment, in right fellowship with him, because you've walked out of something other than love, like giftings. Giftings are good. I mean, it's fun to prophesy. It's fun to speak words of knowledge. It's fun watching people get healed. It's fun praying for people. But if love is not a part of that, it's pointless to us. So if you've operated out of love, listen, if you've had a fight this week out of love, or not out of love, not out of love, come and pray. If you've said a wrong word to someone and you've held a grudge this week, or you've bad-mouthed someone, or you've gossiped about someone, or whatever it might be, love wants to take care of all that today. The husbands and wives, if you fought, come and pray. If you all walk up here, it wouldn't matter to me at all. This is what I'm not saying. I'm not saying that anyone that walks in love does not fail in these areas. We can walk in love and fail in these areas. Jesus said that he's an advocate, and if we do fail, he will come, and he will cover that sin, and he will take that away from us. Let's just be honest today, because listen, let's be honest, because the fact that we have been comfortable walking across the bridge that was not for us. We've been comfortable walking in a place that is without God, without true love from heaven. It's time for us to get out of our comfort zones. It's time for us to walk in the fullness that God has for us. Revival is about ready to explode. And it's not going to come through me, but it's going to come through Jesus. It is actually going to come through him. Revival is going to come through Jesus, not from any man, but from Jesus. So tonight, I encourage you to come, get into the water, and once and for all, melt away everything that the world has ever bound you with, controlled you with, judged you with. Anything that's in your heart that's not of heaven, come and get rid of it. In the water, you can come right now and get rid of it. But I promise you, God's going to change your world. He's going to rock your world. There's something that he's doing in the water. I can't put my finger on it all the way, but there's something that's so amazing that's beyond us. It's so beyond us. And when you start walking in the fullness of love, I think he's going to reveal it to you. He's going to reveal it to all of us when we start walking in the complete fullness of love of who we are and who he is in us. Thank you, Father, for today, for your love, for your mercy. Thank you for the ones here at the altar right now praying, Lord. Father, bless them. Encourage you to take away the pain in their heart, the pain they've suffered. maybe a fight, maybe a harsh word, maybe a judgment. Take those things from them, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, that you are our advocate, that you forgive us of those things, Lord. And we fall, you help us to get back up and you forgive us. If we fall again, you do the same thing over and over and over. If we fall, you help us to get back up and you walk with us. Because we are born into the kingdom of God, we have full access to the kingdom of God. Father, help us to use our keys to the kingdom that you've returned back to us, that we can access and open the door to heaven and have anything we desire to have. But let us desire love most of all. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Come tonight, please. Come tonight. At least come and sit and watch what happens. Watch what God's doing. It's valuable that the people in the outside region come in and they see that we're interested in what we're doing as much as they're interested in what we're doing. So come and see what God's going to do tonight.